Hi, everyone. Can you hear me nice and well? Good to see you this afternoon. I've been slightly the graveyard slot the Friday afternoon, so I'll keep this nice and quick and talk to you about jobs, fundraising, everything in between, opportunities in Web3. I work or run a company called Encode Club. We broadly put it quite nicely here, mint developers. But we do so much more. What we do is we train usually developers at scale for free and help them get jobs and start companies in Web3. We've had over 60 companies come out of Encode, hundreds of people come through our doors and get jobs. And I'm going to try and boil down the secret sauce in this talk today. What we do this through is free education. Things like hackathons, which are coding competitions, general courses, startup accelerators, coding boot camps, and at the end of the funnel, recruitment. And we've been doing it for about 4 years now, but nicely have trained roughly 20,000 people, which is very fun indeed. Our community is over the spread throughout the world, West Europe, US, India, South America, and Africa being particular clusters. But what matters is where we are today. We've had the pleasure of working with a lot of protocols in order to deliver that education. So if you come to an Encode program, you do it in collaboration with perhaps one of these names and many other protocols you would recognize and know. I'm going to take you through from first principles about what opportunities there are in Web3. It should be fairly obvious. I'm not going to do the boring stuff. I'm going to do the cool, like, okay, where is this trend going? If you are looking for a job or to start a company, which will be most reasons you want an opportunity in Web3, how do you get that? Start off with some definitions, which should be obvious. We should all know what blockchain is in this room. It's a piece of technology, a decentralized database technology, which powers this industry broadly called crypto. But the buzzword is Web3, which is, I think, the more interesting one, which is broadly, if I'm going to go very wishy-washy, a vision of the future, about the future of the internet built on crypto and blockchain primitives. Sounds wishy-washy. But obviously, you are here. We are all here because we think it will be something. I think I'm not any maximalist. I'm sure you might be or might not be in this room. But we think crypto is cool technology, and people will invest in it, and it will become more valuable. And there will be opportunities, not just that are available now, that you don't even know about, so that are to come. And they broadly fall in, I think, three categories. The first is obviously jobs. Now, clearly, the size of this event and other events is indicative of the size of the industry, but there are, at least in this year and last year, has been such huge capital investment, mainly on the back of hype, but also, let's call it great technology as well, it is, that pretty much every protocol and company in crypto is hiring hugely, and trying to find those jobs should be a simple task, but getting those jobs is now a very competitive task. The majority of jobs, job takers, are coming from what one might call Web 2, people who are in traditional tech who want to get involved in blockchain. And these jobs broadly fall into categories, obviously, developers and non-developers. Though we specialize on the developer side, I'm going to talk about the non-developer side also. It is clear that there are a few certain types of crypto company. There are protocols, but you can't really work for a protocol by the very nature of it. You work for a foundation that represents or protects the underlying technology, or a labs team. Now, if you are someone who is not working in crypto, the one you want to go to is the labs team. These are people who are providing services for a specific blockchain ecosystem. Let's say Algorand, they're sponsoring this this conference. They're a great partner of ours. They will have an incorporated company who broadly are going to maintain the technology, build services on top of it, and also do the business development and marketing associated. Now, there's already four sets of jobs I've outlined there, and that's just on one ecosystem, and Algorand is a big one. Times that by 50. There's 50 of these. And that's not including the exchanges, both centralized and decentralized, the lending protocols, the stable coins. All of these exist. If it says protocol, it means they have a foundation, which is smaller, but a labs or an incorporator that has many, many jobs. And if any company has raised, they've usually raised at seed or series A level, and they are trying to become a big protocol. It should be obvious there are tons of jobs there. How you position yourself for that, I will go on later in this talk. But broadly, it is A, have an awareness of crypto. B, that should be demonstrable in some sort of experience, or you can talk about it well. And C, it really helps if you're technical. If you are a developer, particularly if you know anything related to JavaScript, but front-end development, data, data science, ML, you will do extremely well because there's a massive shortage of developers in Web3. The problem is, though, you kind of need to know something about crypto. You need to learn something specifically, usually about Solidity, maybe Rust. Solidity is very JavaScript-based. Rust is powers protocols like Solana, Near, others, Move is the next one. So if you are going to be a developer and you're in this room, or you want to be a developer, it is not, you don't just need to have the technical knowledge and ability, you kind of need to have at least a grounding in these technologies. The thing I will tell you is this, and I think it applies less so on the non-developer side. If you have experience in Web3, or rather, every pretty much 6 months of experience in Web3 probably equates to two or three in Web2. That's like a very kind of rough rule of thumb. But the maximum experience you could possibly have on Ethereum development is what? 5-6 years, of which in a major DeFi time, 2-3 years. So if you've got 6 months, like you've already had like a fifth of all the time you could have had in DeFi. So if you have a year, like that compounds and even more. My strong message is if you're a developer, switch to Web3, it'll be profitable for you. Wages are much higher. Non-developer side, also so, but developers are, unfortunately, if you're on the non-technical side, even more in demand. Where do you find jobs? There's a few obvious places to look. There's some, if you just Google, obviously, blockchain and jobs on Twitter would be the place I'd go to first, but also Google, you'll be fine. My little hack, if you're looking to get a job, and I say this as a company that do recruitment, so I'm basically giving you what we do for free, is go on the list of companies that have just, either on Crunchbase or through Mazari or anything, just Google it on TechCrunch, who has raised money, let's say at least 5 million in the last 6 to 12 months. It's probably a few hundred companies in crypto, if not more. They're all, you only raise to hire, so like they are the set of companies that are desperate to hire right now. Target them, go on their job pages. If they haven't got job pages, even better for you, they're not sophisticated enough to have job pages yet, go onto their Discord, message their founder. It's a very hacky way to get a job very quickly in crypto with a company you know is doing, will do well. It's raised a lot of money, or at least will do well for the next 18 months. That's my hack on how to get a job in crypto very quickly. But the key thing in crypto is that capital is huge. Capital investment, even, you've all heard the stories, there's a lot of investment. I'm not talking speculative investment, I'm talking venture capital investment. And pretty much every VC fund has raised record funds this year, like a fund that raised 100 million 3 years ago now has a billion. So like they've got to spend that to try and make money. This will not stop for at least another 12, 24 months if you're worried about crypto, regardless of macro trends, crypto trends. But capital is incredibly high. And that leads to the second thing, which is startups. Most people have high and mighty ideas of what a startup is. And startups are extremely hard, but in crypto, it is easier than most. It's still extremely hard. Of course it is. The technology is probably harder than the average startup, but it is easier for a reason. Of liquidity. Most protocols, most startups are protocols, and most protocols have tokens by their very design, and therefore most tokens need to have liquidity. They need to be tradable. And this minimizes your downside if you're an investor. So I do a lot of angel investing. I invest in a company. I know because if this protocol is something, like it's not going to be worth zero. It's probably actually going to be worth like and roughly its last funding round, like maybe with some factor. So my downside is not zero. The valuation is therefore going to be higher than if this was a normal equity business. Like I'm not in a normal equity business, I invest, it might go bad, I get nothing. In crypto, it goes bad, it's still worth half of its latest fundraising valuation. I've got my money out. Therefore, the valuations will obviously be higher in crypto. This also means if valuations are higher, people will raise more. Altogether, this makes it a, I think, easier but different environment to start a startup. But it's also one where you can be successful in crypto, unfortunately, I say unfortunately, even though it's slightly fortunate, without the protocol ever having achieved success. Most protocols in crypto have achieved monetary success. They are worth a lot of money, but they have not achieved success in terms of anything you would call revenue. If you want to prove that in some way. Go and look at the graph. I think only most of you here have probably heard of the graph. I see some nods. Essential infrastructure for the Ethereum ecosystem has made, I think in total, low six-figure sums of revenue all time, despite being worth at its peak many, many billions. The majority of fees that go to validators is not revenue for providing validation services. It's rewards from the graph to people. It's just giving away cash, not from revenue, but from like as an incentive to keep being a validator. It's a classic Ponzi, unfortunately. And when things go bad, these are Ponzis. When things go well, they're very good game theoretically built systems. If it's speculation fueling it, it's just Ponzi. So all this to say, it's actually much easier to be a founder in crypto. And the win is easier, because you can win without ever actually having achieved anything like product market fit on revenue, just because you make people believe your product is great. Again, look at most crypto protocols. But maybe you think that kind of all doesn't add up, so you shouldn't do it and this won't continue in the long run. That's not for me to say. What I can say is that because of this, raising money in crypto is easier, and there is a hack. I like hacks. I told you the hack for getting a job. Just go and look at who raised money recently and contact those people. The hack for raising money as a founder is do hackathons. Hackathons are effectively coding competitions that either happen in person over a weekend or online. I like online for someone who runs them. They're more scalable, where you build a project very quickly on a new protocol. Trust me, most investors just look at hackathons as the earliest example of a potential startup. And in most hackathons of any note, their winners go on to raise money very quickly. So if you are inclined and technical and like playing around with technology, and by the way, the prizes for hackathons are usually fantastic because most protocols use them as a way to get users. If you want to be a founder, do hackathons and do lots of them. You will meet people, you will learn about new tech, you'll get paid along the way in prizes, and if you're good, you will just raise money very quickly. So hackathons are the key hack. Clearly in this set of things, the word DAO comes up, and I put gritted teeth because I don't think they're very cool. I think at least if you're looking for opportunities in crypto, they are cool in the sense of, okay, you will get to be a contributor, you'll probably get paid for that, but they are no substitute for work, and they cannot employ, and they are not legal entities usually anyway, and if they are a legal entity somewhere, they're kind of not a DAO anymore, without getting into the complications of Cayman tax law. But broadly, if you want a job, DAOs are not the way. If you want to be a founder, I guess you should see them as like glorified Discord groups. They're a nice way to learn and meet people. I would not say they should be ever considered a full-time opportunity. But at least maybe for like a small percentage of the DAO, but it's not scalable in any way, shape, or form. Now, grants is very important. Take the average protocol. The average protocol, for various reasons, mainly speculation, has treasuries of hundreds of millions, if not billions. It doesn't have users, but it's trying to achieve users. It wants people to build on it. Builders are users. It wants lots of transactions, has lots of money. It's going to incentivize that with money. It's why protocols sponsor things like this. Grants are the way to try and get people to build in the medium to long run. So if you are a builder or building something and you want to do a startup and you want to be a founder, but you're not really ready yet and you want a middle step, apply for grant schemes. Now there's, again, ways to hack them. Maybe do the hackathon of that protocol or another thing the initiative the protocol is doing, or go and see them at their booth at something like this and find out how the grant scheme works, or someone that can guide you through the process. But if you get it right and you want to work on a project for 6 to 12 months because you don't really want a long-term job and you don't want to be a founder, every protocol has grant schemes with hundreds of millions sitting in it. It's not a long-term solution. It's effectively a glorified services gig. You will have to hit milestones and tranches if the protocol is being smart about it. But it's a pretty good way to get a nice five-figure sum to build something cool for the benefit of broadly everyone. So I highly recommend. The other opportunity is just general community. Crypto has an uncanny knack of people, the fact you were in this room on a random Friday in Kensington is indicative of this, of building a community around it, despite how nascent it is. So you will enjoy being part of crypto, you're probably already part of it, and enjoy the community effects, the friendly effects, and that is itself a great thing, and it will spur you on to be part of this ecosystem. I don't know how crypto does it, really. It won't probably persist in a bear market, but in a bull market, it's really fun, perhaps because everyone is winning together. The last thing to say, now I'm very biased, so here's the shill. Education matters. Now the good thing is we provide free education because we don't make money in the short term. We make money if you get a job or if you start a company. This is what matters to me, and I don't really care who we make money off because our model is such that we want to make sure education is free and available to all of you, and we don't have to benefit off any particular party. But regardless of whether you go to Encode Club or you go somewhere else, education matters. Education specifically here means you should be clued up on crypto. You probably are, slash think you are, which is the most important thing. Second, if you are going to go on the technical side, every little bit of experience, if you are a dev, you should have a GitHub, you should be producing open source code. That open source code should be have people perhaps using it. It should be battle tested. We've all seen recent hacks that have happened, the Wintermute hack recently being a good example, though that wasn't a code hack, a security hack. When security hacks do happen, it costs people hundreds of millions, and that's why if you're a software developer in crypto, your experience equates to how well you can write code that's secure. And code that is secure is less likely to get hacked, and less likely to get hacked means we less risk of hundreds of millions being drained. Boot camps are one way. Now, as someone who runs boot camps, I can say if you are super fast and super good, boot camp's probably too slow for you. The best way to learn crypto is just to build. And hackathons are the way, I spoke about before. Hackathons are actually the quickest way if you want to learn and to demonstrate building stuff. But boot camps are usually free. They're good. There's loads of them. Encode has them, but I'm not naive enough to think others don't. Do boot camps. Various courses. I think you should always do live courses. Just think education is better served live. It's better consumed live. You're more likely to make friends and contacts who you'll enjoy being with for the long run if you do things live. But do courses. Encode does accelerators, TLDR, they are, you have a project, you want to take projects to the next stage, but you kind of don't really know how to do it, so someone will broadly take a piece of that company. We don't do that. Broadly take a piece of that company in exchange for training you up. Do those. The final message here is that crypto has a lot of cash, and a lot of cash encouraging you and everyone to do bigger and better things in the long run. The benefit of speculation in this ecosystem is that it might just will itself into being because it just has so much behind it. So many people, so much capital, and as a result of that, the opportunities for your myriad. If you want the short-term job, do the hacky thing I said, or just Google it. If you want to do a startup, do hackathons. If you just want to learn, like probably join a DAO and do some live courses. And if you stay in crypto for broadly 2 years, I don't see how you don't do very well for yourself, certainly better than if you were in Web2. So I'm going to end it there. Hopefully I'm on time, maybe not. Thank you very much.